Miss Nigeria.
I was happy because it was the first time a black African was winning that contest. And in the eyes of the white people, they know that we have beauty.
On the 7th of December, here at the International Conference Center in Abuja, more than 2,000 journalists and 150 broadcasters were to attend the Miss World 2002 finals. It was to be a spectacle which promised to turn the spotlight on beauty, but also on the Amina Lawal case. For Nigeria, Miss World 2002 was to be a perfect opportunity to promote its image abroad. Instead, the recent riots have served only to portray Nigeria as a country rife with unresolved religious tensions. With a population of over 120 million in 250 ethnic groups, Nigeria is one of the largest countries in Africa. The economy is dependent upon oil, which represents 95% of its exports and 46% of its gross domestic product. Thanks to its rich natural and human resources, Nigeria has the potential to become a wealthy country. But Nigeria is a country in profound crisis. Today, more than 66% of the population lives below the poverty line, and Nigeria is among the 20 poorest nations in the world. Over 42 million Nigerians are illiterate. HIV/AIDS, high infant mortality, and malaria are the main social plagues. Nigeria's progress towards modernization is further hampered by religious and ethnic conflict between Muslims of the north and Christians of the south. The Amina Lawal case is just the tip of the iceberg.
There are three main religions in Nigeria: Christianity, Islam, and the African traditional religions. Islam and Christianity are foreign. Christianity came in by the sea, and so is stronger in the south. Islam came in through the desert, and therefore is stronger in the north. There is no country in the world that has so many Muslims living side by side with so many Christians. So our country is a special case, and I would say a privileged area to test the possibility of Muslims and Christians to live together.
Once a British colony, Nigeria gained its independence in 1960. For most of the last 40 years, it was a military state.
General Abubakar will hand over a copy of the Constitution of the Federal Republic.
In 1999, after democratically held elections, Olusegun Obasanjo, a Southern Christian, became president of the country.
12 months ago, no one could have predicted the series of stunning events that made it possible for democratic elections. You, the good people of Nigeria, elected me. I believe that this is what God Almighty has ordained for me and for my beloved country, Nigeria.
Of 36 states that make up federal Nigeria, 12 states in the north, where Muslims make up the majority of the population, have introduced Sharia penal law, a strict interpretation of the Sunnah and the Quran.
This is a file sourced from the Guardian Library, and this is a file now on update on Sharia and the Amina Lawal, because it's still an ongoing case. The Sharia question, a lot of questions are being raised. If you are a Muslim and from the north, you are likely to be supporting the Sharia. But if you are a southerner, a Christian, you are not likely to be supporting it.
Sharia law is part and parcel of the life and living and faith of a Muslim.
Sharia is law, but it extends beyond the legal. Islamic scholars say Sharia is not something the intelligence of a man can prove wrong. They say it's only accepted by humans since it's based on the will of God. Sharia is and always has been part of Nigerian Muslim tradition, but the penal code or had punishments were banned by the British.
With the inception of this administration, the civilian government in place in Nigeria, there are agitations across northern Nigeria, like there have been agitations in northern Nigeria since independence, for the reintroduction of the Islamic penal legislation that affects hard punishments, what they call haddi in Islam.
According to Sharia law, there are five main crimes: robbery, murder, alcohol consumption, adultery, and blasphemy. Punishments for which can include hand amputation, the death penalty, and lashes.
I respect very much religion, and I think that every believer has the right to apply his own religion. But what I do believe is that when a sin becomes automatically a crime, that is a real disaster. Not only is the total beginning of intolerance that will never allow a different kind of people to live together with mutual respect and tolerance. On top of that, particularly the Sharia, is really an interpretation of the Quran that not all Muslim countries, for instance, apply.
The Islamic legal system, the world over, anywhere you find it, has been codified and modified to some extent. That is why it is wrong to assume that Islamic legal system does not change with time. It is wrong to have that perception. So if you look at the history of the world, the Islamic world, Saudi Arabia probably remains the only country in the whole wide world that practices a Sharia uncodified and unmodified.
This different interpretation, it's a breach in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. If we say that human rights are universal, of course you cannot, it's totally unacceptable that a woman, in this case, a citizen, generally speaking, is condemned, sentenced to death, because he was so unlucky to be born in Sudan or in Nigeria or in Yemen or in Spain during the Inquisition.
We take a break now. When we come back, part two of the documentary. Stay with us.